friends, today we are going to start with the first chapter of history from class 6. Dear students, before starting this chapter, I want to ask some questions from you. Like, can you tell me what happened one day before or what happened yesterday? I think if you want to tell me what happened yesterday, you will read the news, you will watch the news on TV, or you will listen the radio, because yesterday is not the farthest thing, it is the nearest thing to us. Okay, tell me if I want to ask you what happened a year before, then what will you do? I think then you will ask from somebody who could remember about what happened a year before. For example, you all know about your previous class, who were your teachers, who were your classmates, etc. So, to tell about 1 year before was not a big issue. Okay, tell me again, what will you do if somebody asks you what happened thousands of years before? So, to know about what happened hundreds of years ago, you will read the books, you will read the autobiographies or biographies written by the great authors. In those books, they have written about what happened 100 years before. Okay, at last, if somebody asks you, what will you know or how will you know about what happened thousands of years before, then what will you do? I think there is no one who knows about what happened thousands of years before. To know about this, about thousands of years, you have to read history. So, to know about what happened thousands of years ago, you have to read about history. What is history? History is the study of past. Yes, history is the study of past. History is always based upon the facts for which we have all the evidences. It tells us about people, their activities, their professions, their way of living, their cultures, their traditions, and so on. So, history means it tells us about all the story of man. So, history of man can be divided into two parts. Number one, prehistory. Prehistory. What do you mean by prehistory? Prehistory means the history for which we do not have any written record. To know about prehistory, we have to read, we have to study about the remains of past, like pots, ornaments, like tools, like weapons. Means we have to read about all the archaeological sources and no written record. Yes, second is history. The second part of history is called history. It means the history for which we have all the written records. Written records in the form of? Written records in the form of manuscripts, in the form of literary sources like travelogues, write chronicles, etc. So, this is all about history. If we want to know what happened a year ago, thousands year ago, hundreds year ago, then we have to read history, because history tells us about the history of man. Now, there is next question in your book, that is, what type of people were there in the past, which types of food they ate, like which types of clothes they wore in the past, or which kinds of houses in which they lived. So history tells us about people that were in the past. Second, we can say lives and occupations. Lives and occupations of herders, hunters, farmers, rulers, and so on. So history tells us about how the life of herder was different from hunter, how hunter's life was different from farmer, and how farmer's life was different from ruler. In this way, we come to know about the lives of these people, what they did in the past. So all these things we get only from the past. Number three, we can know about children. Like, we come to know which types of games were played by children in the past. Number two, we come to know about which types of songs sung by these children, or we come to know about which types of plays was saw by these people. So history tells us about all these things. So what can we know from the past? We can know so many things from the past about people, about their lives, what was their profession. Occupation is profession. How children played, how which songs they sang, and which types of plays they saw. So this all these things we come to know from only from past. Now there is next question that is also given in your book, that is, and this is the most important question: where did people live? So this is very important question that is in your book: where did people live in the past? As we study history, we come to know about so many places which tells us that the earliest people might live there, because we have all the evidences that were found by the archaeologists. Like here, I'm going to write 2-3 places which shows that earliest people might live there. Number one, Narmada River. I think all of you are aware about this river. This river lies or flows in the center of India. Flows in the center of India. When we study history, we have found that earliest people lived on the banks of this river, and the people who lived on the bank of this river were the skilled gatherers. Who were skilled gatherers? The word skilled means perfect, and gatherers means who collect their food. Yes, these people collected their food like seeds, like roots, like eatables from their surrounding for their own food. They have also vast knowledge of plants that surrounds them. They are very well aware about the vast variety of plants that grows around them, and they also hunted animals for their food. Yes, they also hunted animals for their food. So this is the first place, that is Narmada River, where the earliest people called skilled gatherer lived for many thousands or hundreds of years ago. Next place is Sulaiman and Kirthar Hills. Pakistan. But around 8,000 years ago, our archaeologists have found so many evidences which tells us that the earliest people lived in these hills. And here the women and men grow crops for the first time, and they grow two main crops, that is wheat and barley. Yes, they grow these two crops, wheat and barley, for the first time in these hills. And they also started rearing animals like goat, sheep and cattle for their own use. So these are the hills where we found those people who grow wheat and barley around 8,000 years ago, and they also started rearing goat, sheep and cattle. So our next place is Garo Hills. Yes, what do you mean by Garo Hills? These hills lie in the northeast of India. Northeast of India. These are lie in northeast of India, or we can say in Meghalaya state. So these are the hills where we find, where archaeologists find that the earliest people started developing agriculture, or we can say agriculture developed. First agriculture was developed in these hills, and here people started living as a settled agriculture, and they know how to grow crops, how they have to look after their crops. In this, for the purpose of looking after their plants, they have to stay at the same place for many years. In this way, we can say that the idea of family also emerged, because they have to stay at the one place and they develop their families at the same place. Next is Vindhyas. Vindhyas Hills. Yes, these hills also lie in the west center of India. Yes, these hills, or we can say Madhya Pradesh, these hills lie in the west center of India. In these places, our archaeologists have also found that they also developed agriculture at these places also, and they grow crops for the first time in the north of India, in Vindhya. So they grow rice for the first time in the north of Vindhyas. So this was the fourth place. Now come to Indus and its tributaries. Yes, students, I think all of you know what is Indus. Indus is the river, or this is the longest river in the world. And what do you mean by tributary? Tributary means small river that flows into the main river. Like this is the main river, and these are small river that flows into the main river. So this is Indus River, and its tributaries are like Satluj, Ravi, Chelam, Chenab. So tributaries are small rivers that flows into main river. Or we can say that around 4700 years ago, 47 ago, the earliest people lived on the banks of this river, or they established cities. So this is about Indus and its tributary. And the last place about which we will read in this book is Ganga and its tributary. Yes, student. Number 5 is Ganga and its tributary. Tributaries. All of you know what is Ganga, the main river of India, and its tributaries are like Son, Kosi, etc. So around 2500 years ago, 2500 years ago, cities also established on the banks of river Ganga, and people started doing trade after that. And we can also want to state that in ancient time, the areas along these rivers, especially to the south of Ganga, was known as Magadha area. To the south of Ganga was known as Magadha. What is Magadha? It was a very powerful or important kingdom. Its rulers were very important, and this Magadha lies in the state of Bihar. But after that, we have found so many other important kingdoms along the banks of river or in the country as well. So in this way, this is the answer of our question: where did earliest people live? We have studied about Narmada River. We have studied about Suleiman and Kirthar Hills that lies in the northwest. Then we studied about Garo Hills, lies in the northeast part of India. Vindhya Hills, that lies in the west central part of India. Then we have studied about Indus and its tributary, on the banks of this river, earliest cities flourished. After that, we have studied about Ganga and its tributary. Around 2500 years ago, cities also developed on the banks of river Ganga, and then people established important powerful kingdoms like Magadha, and there are so many other kingdoms in the city. After that, there is also one main question, that is, why do people travel from one part of the subcontinent to another? Yes, this is a question again which I will discuss now. So first of all, what is subcontinent? Subcontinent means part of the continent that is smaller than a continent, but it is very large, and it is separated from the rest of Asia by hills, by mountains, or by sea. Our South Asia is always referred to as subcontinent. Now the question is, why people travel from one part of subcontinent to another? There are so many reasons why people were moving at the time. The first reason was in search of livelihood. In search of livelihood, yes. People want to earn money, so they have to move from one place to another place just to earn money. Second reason, we can say, to escape from natural disasters. What do you mean by natural disasters? Natural calamities like floods or droughts may come occur any time. So people have to leave their place and they have to move to the another place. Number three, merchants moved to sell their products. We can say merchants always traveled in caravans. Caravans means they always moved from one place to another in groups, and they always carried their valuable objects on ships for the purpose of selling, and they also move from one place to another. Next is to conquer others' land. What is the meaning of conquer? To win. Sometimes men and women marched in armies just for the purpose of conquering others' land. In this way, they moved from one part of the subcontinent to another. Next one is religious teachers taught or gave advices on the way. Yes, in the past, the religious teachers also moved from one place to another just to give their instructions, to give their guidelines to the people who came on their way. Next is for the purpose of spirit of adventure. Adventure means to do something different. It means sometimes people want to explore new places only to fulfill their aim. They move from one place to another, or we can say that for the purpose of, for the spirit of doing something different, they move from one place to another. So these are the reason why people travel from one part of subcontinent to another: to earn livelihood, to escape from natural disaster, or to sell their valuable products, or to win others' land, or religious teachers gave instructions to the people, and at last for the purpose of doing adventure, they move from one place to another. Now, here I want to tell you one thing that in the subcontinent, like hills, mountains, all these seas, they form the natural frontier. Means to cross this subcontinent was not an easy task. It was very difficult because people have to cross big mountains, seas, deserts, hills. But people did in this past. People from across the frontier came to India just for the purpose of sharing their ideas with each other. And this led to the, this has enriched our India's tradition. Means people know from each other new ways of cooking. They learn how to compose music, and they learn so many things from each other. Or we can say that this movement of people has led to the sharing of ideas between each other. So this is all about the reasons of moving of people from one place to another. Yes, our next question is names of the land. Names of the land. Yes, student. Land means country. Yes, student. We often call our country, or we often use two words for our country, that is India and Bharata or Bharat. Yes. Yes, student. How do the word India comes from, or where does the word India came from? I can say the word India comes from the river Indus. As we have studied earlier, the river Indus is also known as Sindhu in Sanskrit language. India comes from the river Indus, and Indus is also known as Sindhu in Sanskrit. When Iranians and Greeks who lived in northwest part of India, they were very well known about this river, and they call this river as Indus or Indus. So these names were given by to this river by Greeks and Iranians, and they also call the land that is to the southeast of Indus as India. We can say land to the east of Indus as India. Indus as India. In this way, we got the name India for our country. So once again, I'm going to repeat. We use two words for country, India and Bharat. The word India comes from the river Indus. It is also known as Sindhu in Sanskrit. But Iranians and Greeks who lived in northwest part of India, they called this river as Hindus or Indus. And they were very familiar about this river, and they call the land that is to the south of Indus as India. Now come to Bharata. The word Bharata comes from a group of people who also lived in northwest part of India. We can say group of people who lived in the north west part of India. Northwest part of India. Or we can say that they were tribes, or they were tribal people. And about this, they are also mentioned in Rig Veda. What is Rig Veda? The oldest Sanskrit composition. So from this we got the name Bharata for our country. So this is the history behind the names of our country, that is India and Bharata. India word comes from river Indus, and Bharat word comes from those people who lived in the northwest part of India, and these peoples are also mentioned in Rig Veda, the old Sanskrit composition. So this is all about names of the land. Yes, student, our next topic is finding out about past. Yes, student, what does it mean? It means that we know a lot of things from past. So what are the sources? Name the sources from which we get all this information. So we have so many sources, like archaeological sources, literary sources, from which we come to know about our past. Here in this book, I have 2-3 sources which tells us about past. Like number one, manuscripts. What do you mean by manuscripts? Handwritten books or records, we can say. Yes, manuscripts means handwritten books or handwritten records. The word manu means hand, and the word script means writing. So the books which were written by hand in the past are known as manuscripts, and these books were written on palm leaves. On which leaves? Palm leaves. Or they were also written on the bark of beech tree. What is bark? Branch. Bark of beech tree. And these trees are mostly grows in Himalayas. Yes, and these trees in Himalayas. Yes. Over the years, these manuscripts have destroyed because insects have eaten all these manuscripts. But some of these manuscripts have even survived today, and they also tell us about so many subjects, or we can say that they were written on different subjects, like means these different were written on different subjects like science and medicine. They give us detail about what is science, what are the medicine, or how they are made, and these were written on manuscripts like lives of kings. What was the life of king, how they lived, etc., about the victories of king. Victories of king. So these were the subjects on which those manuscripts were written in the past. Yes, here I also want to tell you that the language in which manuscripts were written, they were written in Sanskrit language. Sanskrit language. They were also written in Prakrit language. What do you mean by Prakrit language? Ordinary language. Ordinary language. What is ordinary language? The language that was spoken by the earliest people, or the native language of earliest people, was Prakrit language. And manuscripts were also written in Tamil language. Most of the people of South wrote manuscripts in only Tamil language. So this is all about the first source of information about the past. What is manuscripts? Handwritten records are called manuscripts. These were written on palm leaves, on bark of birch trees, and these trees grows in Himalayas. And these were the subjects, these were written on science, about medicine, about the lives of king, about the victories of king. And these were written in two, three languages like Sanskrit, Prakrit language, Tamil language, and Pali language also. So this is the first source of information. Second is, inscriptions. What do we mean by inscription? Inscriptions means study writings written on the hard surfaces. Writings on the hard surface. Writing on the hard surface like stone, pillar, etc. So the writings that were written on hard surfaces like stone or pillar was known as inscription. Why they were written on this hard stone? Because kings got their messages inscribed on these rocks, on these matters, so that the people could see, people could read, and people could obey their order. Sometimes these were written on the other purpose also, like kings and queens want to record what they did, like they want to keep the record of their victories, how many victories, how many battles they have won. So these are written for the different purpose as we have studied, to obey the orders inscribed on them. Number two, about the record of their victories. Record of their victories. So this is about inscription. Inscriptions means writings written on the hard surface, like stone, like pillar, metal, etc. And our next source of information is archaeology. study of the remains of the past is called archaeology. It means there were so many things, so many objects that were made in the past, and when we study these things, these objects, then that study is called archaeology. The things, the objects like tools, weapons, coins, pots, so many things are there, and the people who know, who do the study of all these objects are known as archaeologists. People who study these objects, yes, like tools, coins, etc. So this is the third source of information, archaeology. It means a scientific study of the remains of past is known as archaeology. And the remains are like building, like pot, like weapon, anything can be there. And the people who study all these remains are known as archaeologists. They study the remains of building, whether they are made up of stone, whether they are made of mud, whether they are made up of brick. They also study about the bones also. They want to know the bones were of bird, of any fish or any animal. Why do they study about bones? Just to find out that what people ate in the past. Once they found the sources, then it becomes an adventure to find out about all the past. So this is our next information. Next are historians. Historians are called scholars. Historians are called scholars who study the past. Once they found the sources from the past, or we can say once they found the information from the manuscripts, from archaeology, from inscription, then they start doing work on these things to find out what was history, what was the history of man, etc. So these historians and archaeologists, they are just like detectives. Means when they found the clues, they start finding out about past, what happened, why happened. So many questions are there which they try to know. So these are all about the sources of information about the past. We have studied here about manuscript, handwritten record. We have studied about inscription, means writings written on hard surfaces. Then we study about archaeology, means a scientific study of the remains of past. Then we study about archaeologists, but the people who study about the remains of past. Then we have read about historians, means scholar, who study the past, who collect information from all these sources and start doing working upon them. After that, our next question is, one past or many? Question is, one past or many? Have you noticed the title of your history book, Our Past? Why do we have used the word past, or we use a plural form for the word past? Because everyone's past is different from each other. Everyone's culture, practices, they all are different from each other. We can say in the past, the life of kings and queens was totally different from the lives of farmers and herders. Like kings and queens lived in palaces and they lived in huts. They wore costly clothes and they wore simple clothes. Means there are so many differences we can find. So everyone's past is different from each other. Like the life of merchant is different from craft person. So differences are the continuous process which we study in the past. So this process is same as even today also. Means the people living in, for an example, living in and the people living in Andaman and Nicobar Island, they depend on fishing for hunting or for forest produce for their living. Means they have to depend on these things for their survival. At the same time, the people living in cities, they do not have to depend on fishing, on hunting, on any forest produce, but they have to depend on others for their survivors. Depend on others for their survival. So, in this way, everyone's past is different from past, present or future is different from each other. Here I want to give you one more example. Like, we have all the record of kings and queens, which types of battles they won, which types of battles they fought. But why do we do not have the records of common people? Because they were not interested in keeping the record of their own activities. Because the reasons may be many, like maybe they were illiterate. So many reasons were there. So this is all about one past or many past. Means everyone is different from each other. Everyone's beliefs, practices, customs are different from each other. After that, our last topic is, that is very important, what do dates mean? Very important to know about history. We should have the knowledge of dates. Yes, student, if somebody asks you the date, what will you say? You will probably say the date, the month and year. Like 2020, I can say today is May 27, 2020. But have you ever tried to know how these dates are numbered or counted? So I want to tell you that these years are counted to the dates assigned to the birth of Jesus Christ. Here I am giving you a timeline just to make you understand about the concept of dates. Suppose this is year 0, or we can say that this year was the birth of Jesus Christ. BC. Yes, please listen carefully. It means this year is known as the birth of Jesus Christ. So all the dates, all the years that came before the birth of Jesus Christ are counted backward, like 500, 1000, 1500, and always the words BC are also added on it. But the dates that are counted after the birth of Jesus Christ, they are not counted backwards, and always the word AD is written at it, with them. So the word AD, what does the word AD means? It is a Latin word. It means Anno Domini, or we can say in the year of Lord. AD is also known as CE. What is mean? Common Era. Today we also use the word BP. BP stands for before present. This is the concept of date, like the years that came before the birth of Jesus Christ are counted backwards, but the years that came after the birth of Jesus Christ are not counted as backward. Always before the birth of Jesus Christ, we added the word BC with it. BC stands for before Christ. We can also write BCE, means before common era. And after the birth of Jesus Christ, we do not count the dates, years, not backward, but we use the word AD with them, because AD stands for in the year of Lord. And we can also write CE. CE means common era. Today we use the word BP, means before present. In India, this form of dating had just started 200 years ago. So this is all about the concept of date. So today is just the introduction of history to make you understand about the concept of history. We will read about more history as we move with the new chapters of history. So this is enough for today. Thank you. Have a nice day.